This is The Soul Garden, presented by me, Georgina Langdale, for the Centre for Nature Connection, and it's where we get to explore nature, compassion, and soul through the inner and outer workings of living in a connected world. It gives me really great pleasure to welcome Thomas Moore here today to The Soul Garden. And it's really wonderful to have such a carer of the soul here with me today. Hello, Thomas. How are you doing?
Hello, Georgina. So nice to see you and be with you.
Yeah, it's lovely to have you here. Thomas, of course, you're many things. You're best-selling author, psychotherapist, former monk, and a musician. I first discovered you some years ago when I bought your book, The Planets Within, about the wonderful Marsilio Ficino, the 15th century philosopher and scholar and physician of the soul. I've gone on to read many more of your books since then, I have to confess. Marsilio got me hooked. And I've read your lovely best-selling book, Care of the Soul, and also books like Care of the Soul and Medicine, plus many others. More recently, I've had the really thoroughly enjoyable experience of being one of your students in your soul psychology online course, which was really enjoyable and very thought-provoking, and I thoroughly recommend it to anybody who is interested in having a look at that. But Thomas, you've got a new book out, Soul Therapy, The Art and Craft of Caring Conversation. So congratulations on that. It's what number book is this for you now that you've written?
I think it's 25. It depends how you count them. I think it is though, 25.
Gosh, that's quite an achievement. Before we get going, I thought first up, can you describe for listeners and viewers here, what you mean by the elements of body, soul, and spirit?
I think we could start with spirit, maybe. Mm. I see these as the traditions. There's a tradition going back 2,000 years talking about these things. I like the tradition that says that spirit is that element in us or that aspect of human life that wants to get beyond the place where it is at the moment. It wants to it's not just religious. It's even when the scientists send a rocket to Mars, that's spirited. It's the spirit in the human being that wants to transcend where it is and go find other places. Explorers were full of spirit. Pilots tend to be full of spirit up in the air. They love to be free of the ground and obstacles. That's also spirit. Mm. Of course, it has, and sometimes it has a religious expression, like people wanting to meditate and contemplate and not be limited by their body and by their activities, daily activities. So that's also a spirit. Mm. And that's wonderful. It allows us to be creative and explorers and adventurers. But there's another side to us that is the soul, which is very different, but very important also. And that is the part of us that likes to be home and comforted and in our families or with friends or eating together. Or all these intimate things that are so important that make the tradition says that the soul makes us human. Yes. See, the spirit gets us beyond our humanity in a way.
Yeah, and beautiful.
The soul keeps us human and close to those things that are intimate and simple and very precious to us. Mm-hmm. And that's where we get attached to our homes and to people and to things. And from the soul point of view, it's excellent, wonderful to be attached, even though for the spirit it isn't.
Sometimes people ask me the question, where does soul inhabit the body? How do you answer that?
Well, Aristotle and other early philosophers said the soul inhabits every part of the body. Mm. I like that answer.
Yeah.
So,
yeah. So, and they say that every organ has its own soul as well, or something. Yeah.
Yes. I know. I play the piano, and I know that my fingers have soul.
Yeah.
You know, when I play, it's like they're alive and they do things, and I let them play, and it's not exactly me. I let them have their life.
Yes, I really understand that as a erstwhile guitarist. I'm really interested in placing much of the context of our conversation today in the space of end-of-life care. And I'm doing this because, firstly, I think it's a part of life that arouses such great fear and often great disconnect between people. Yet, you know, soul is there within us and kind of hovering about. And so part of the work I do is I'm trying to open up a space for discussion around how we care for people at the end of life, regardless actually from whether we're a health professional or a therapist or a non-medical carer, such as a death doula or a family member. A question that comes up a lot, I think for many people working in this space, how do I even begin to have a conversation with my loved one about practicalities and wishes around care in the event of accident, illness, or death? And I'm wondering if you can share your thoughts on that question and how soul can play a part in navigating that.
I think that this is very close to what I've written about in this new book of mine, about having these caring conversations. Mm. And what I talk about there, really, really talking to somebody at the end of life is not all that different from talking to them in life, mm-hmm. especially at moments that are particularly full of emotion or meaning. And that's really... I think you have to have, in a way, the way I say in that book is we each of us can be therapists.
Yeah.
In the sense that we can each talk differently, you have to be friends and talk as people, but there's an art to it too. There's an art to speaking to people at that time. Mm-hmm. And part of that art has to do with feeling comfortable and confident within yourself.
Mm.
So if you feel okay about the whole of human life, including dying, then what you say to the person and what you convey to them will be that confidence and ease. Mm. And whatever words you use, that's what you will show, the way you talk to a person and the way you are with them. I think that's where it starts. It starts with who you are and how you have prepared yourself. Have you prepared yourself to be in the presence of dying? One of the things that I feel is important is the way we talk to people. That's a big part of my book, is how do you talk and how do you listen?
Mm.
You know, how do you listen best? What do you say? Because we can make mistakes. We can do things that really don't help the situation.
Yeah.
For example, let me just mention some of the things maybe we shouldn't do.
Yeah.
I don't think that it's terribly useful to give people advice or tell them what you think they should do, because we're all different. And what's good for you may not be good for the other person. And people are very complex. They have very rich histories. And there's no way you can know who that person is that you're talking to. I remember my friend James Hillman, who is a very brilliant guy who spent his whole life studying so deeply in issues of theology and philosophy and art and psychology and psyche. There's no one better that I've ever met. And he was dying, and they had a group of hospice people come in to him who just couldn't deal with him. You know, he had thought these things through so much in his life, and they were giving him these simple you know, pious, you know, sayings that it just, I don't know, it'd be like bringing a pizza to a great chef, you know, it just wasn't the thing.
Yeah.
So they had to find a hospice people who could talk to him, and they did. Mm. There were people. Didn't have to be brilliant, but they had to be open to this person for who he was.
Mm.
And I think that's a good example for me of how we, when we talk to people, we have to allow for their own history and their own tastes and their own life, who they have become, if you can know them at all. So that means you have to listen to them a lot. And the most important form of expression of the soul is narrative, story. Mm-hmm. If you can hear stories from their life, you get to know them a bit. Then what you say might be relevant in some way. It might actually help. If you're not trying to take them where you think they need to be, that's the worst thing.
Yeah.
Don't try to take them where you think they need to be.
Yeah.
Take them where they need to be. You have to really work at it to get to know where they need to go or want to go.
Yeah.
So there's a great deal of cooperation going on, and not passivity on the part of the helping person, but openness and being able to receive who the person is. So you don't go saying the wrong things that are totally irrelevant or might go against what this person is, in that case with Hillman.
Yeah.
So that's a big part of it. You do have to watch out for that. And another thing would be not to tell people your own particular values, you know, impose them on the person, or mm-hmm. your own thoughts about what you think is so valuable and important.
Mm-hmm.
That's only for you. If you're doing that, it's to satisfy you, not to help the person.
Right.
So you have to really be cautious of that. And you have to be careful not to get caught by who that person is and what they say. To be like, sometimes something that they say may get you angry, or you may disagree with them. Yeah. If you get caught emotionally in that, you're not going to be of any use.
Yes.
So I have a chapter in my book on serenity and neutrality.
Great.
Of how important it is to be neutral.
Yeah.
You know, not take sides and not get into arguments and not be moralistic, but to be neutral no matter what happens. Not to be caught in something that is said that just grabs you because that's your complex you have, something about it.
Yeah.
But to practice your neutrality. And when you're talking to someone, say, I'm just going to be there as a listener. And if something comes up that kind of stirs me up, I'm not going to react.
Mm-hmm.
I'm going to be present and not argue any points at all.
I like things like Buddhist philosophy that puts death up right up front, kind of in life. And in a way, I love the freedom that gives, that it helps then go, okay, I see death as part of life. Now I can really experience life in the present moment. One of the things I've noticed in conversations with health professionals is sometimes that feeling of needing to be equipped with skills to ask, how are you as to the whole person rather than just to the medical condition? What are your thoughts around that?
Well, I spent about 5 years of my career working almost entirely with medical people.
Mm.
I was in hospitals constantly, and I was working with chaplains a lot. But then I would visit and talk to every single group in the hospital. And I worked a lot with hospice people too, and have visited many, many hospices and have spoken to their personnel and to the patients. And so what I found out originally I'll tell you the story. I was just sort of sitting around, and I had published Care of the Soul. This was a long time ago, 30 years ago. And I got a phone call from a physician who was thousands of miles from me, and asked me if I would come and speak to his staff because they were having trouble working with their patients who were in a hospice setting. And I got there and I found out that the staff, I was shocked really. They didn't know how to deal with death and with dying. Mm. I had to learn a great deal.
Yeah.
Started out by learning that they felt their job was to keep people alive. And they felt death was a defeat.
Yes.
And so what I did with them, I spent a few days with them just trying to get to the point where we could talk about dying as more comfortably and as part of their work. That this was not a defeat, that this was part of their work, and we die. It's like living. Part of our living is to die. And sorting that through with the medical professionals, I think, is extremely important. And my guess is that situation is still common today.
Yeah, I was reading, doing some research recently, and there's something like only 18% of medical students in the States get any form of end-of-life training and training around talking about dying. And about 50% of them said they just feel totally ill-equipped about how to deal with it at all. I had a discussion with a GP here, and I asked her here in New Zealand, and I asked her a similar question, and she said, we're taught how to break bad news.
Yes.
And then I kept sort of saying, but what about a conversation around dying? Yeah, we're taught how to break bad news, kept coming back. And then in the end, she suddenly went, oh, no, we're not taught how to talk about dying. So the soul approach to care and the soul approach to dying, can you talk a little bit more about how that opens up a conversation for a health professional?
Yes, the soul is really, the soul material. It's really about ordinary things, the things that really are meaningful to us. And it's an awareness. When you work with soul, you're aware that the simplest things have a great deal of meaning and layers of meaning. Mm-hmm. They signify a great deal. And I remember once, one of the first talks I gave at a big hospital, a big cancer center, all the doctors gave their highly technical talks. And I stood up and talked about how important it was to discuss the memories that people have when they're dying. People usually like to talk about things that they remember or people they remember. It doesn't take much to get that conversation going, just a little prompt and they're off.
Yeah.
And if you're able to listen to that and understand that this is important, memory is one of the chief qualities of soul. The past is very important. It's not a defense against anything. It's very real and important.
Yes.
And so another thing, simple thing. So I was talking about this, and I think some of the doctors there were a bit skeptical. And a hospice worker stood up and said, described how that morning, the day before, one of her patients told her how she missed a banana nut bread. Mm-hmm. And so the hospice worker made some banana nut bread and gave it to the woman, and she died that day and was quite happy. And wonderful. This banana nut bread was, I thought that was a wonderful example.
That is a wonderful, and the beautiful mundanity of it as well is so gorgeous, isn't it?
And there's a richness because it contained the memories of other banana nut moments she had in her life. That was very important.
Yeah, I remember my father, he died of dementia, and so over the years of that slow kind of descent, I spent a lot of time in the care home that he was in. And there was a gentleman there who was blind. And in autumn, as I was walking to this place, I picked up all these autumn leaves. And when I got in there, I crunched them for him and he started just telling stories.
Yeah.
Which makes me think about when you look back through time and we look at people like Marsilio Ficino in the 15th century, Paracelsus in the 16th century, Hildegard von Bingen in the 12th, Hippocrates. The thread that ran through everything was that our health and well-being was seen in relationship, in our relationship to nature and to cosmos. So I've got two questions. Why do you think we've lost that? And what are your hopes for us getting it back?
We lost it, I think, because we went through a major transformation in our view of life. And that had to do with the beginnings of a particular kind of science. In the Middle Ages and the Renaissance in Europe, at least, there was, before then, science was related to theology and to philosophy. That connection got lost. And so it became, what happened with science becoming so materialistic, so focused on just the objects and substances, was that we lost our connection to nature. We lost our philosophy that included nature in our whole unified way of looking at the world. Today we are split off. Hardly anyone's interested in philosophy or theology anymore. It used to be the main concerns, the main issue, main focus of learning. These are wonderful things. Theology is really about trying to explore the mysteries of life. And one of those would be death. Theologians are the ones who think about life and death. And philosophers about the world we live in and our relationship to it. And we've lost that. And the poets who, like Wordsworth and, people, writers like here for us, right near where I live, was Henry David Thoreau and Waldo Emerson and Emily Dickinson. These people understood so well that nature is part of our meaningful existence. Our relation to nature is where we find our meaning and purpose.
Yes, yes. And also I think that understanding of when we look, well, Einstein said the deeper we look into nature, the more that we understand everything better. And I think for me, I've found connecting to nature has meant connecting to soul. So how is nature showing up in the advice that you're giving in this, in your latest book, Soul Therapy?
Nature shows up not a whole lot, but it does show up, especially when I suggest that people who are talking to others who are in distress, it's not easy, and it can really be difficult for a person to be doing that. And if they want to get inspiration and if they want to get courage, they should go into the natural world and just be there and notice it. Because we are of nature, and you don't have to understand it with your mind. You just have to be there and watch and notice how birds and animals and how trees grow and what water is like. It doesn't take much to humanize a person, to give them depth. That's what they need to go then and talk to somebody else, because they have been humanized by nature.
I found that some of the people going through my courses and things, one of the things I encourage them to do is when they're with a patient or with a family member or whoever it is, to really explore questions with them around, with the patient around the landscapes they love, the plants, animals, whatever, those places they love, so that then they can tuck it away in their little toolbox or medicine bag. And as time goes on, I've seen it incredibly helpful, even just trying to guide them on a visualization through that landscape again and things can be incredibly comforting and things. Here at the Center for Nature Connection, we help people deepen their connection to nature and live a life filled with compassion and soul. Working with ancient concepts of the way health and well-being is deeply linked to nature and cosmos, we provide one-on-one consultations to help you find your star. We offer coaching, online training, and the Natural Carer Program for death doulas and people looking after people at the end of life. Check us out at centernatureconnection.org, and every purchase helps support eco-restoration and plant conservation projects. I'd like to actually move on to grief now. Can you talk about soul and grief and how you feel therapists, friends, doctors, whoever can support people who are bereaved from a soul-based approach?
Yes. The soul point of view is to have the experience, even though it is painful, to take it as one of the ways of being human, one of the ways you make sense of your life. And even though it's painful, one of those experiences you need to have to be who you are.
Yeah.
And it will, what it does, the experience of grief can activate elements in you that have been asleep or never really came to life before. Mm. You may learn from your grief that you are so connected to the world and to people. If you have so much grief, that means you are attached.
Yeah.
In a way. That's the soul thing, to be attached. And to the person who's grieving, attached to another person, but also attached to life itself and to being alive. Because when you're talking to someone who is grieving, in a way, you participate in their grief. You feel your own grief in relationship to it. Mm-hmm. And that wakes you up. I always say that the person who is doing therapy is always in therapy.
Yes. You know, it's like
when you're talking to someone about difficult things or painful things, you are not only helping them, you are helping yourself.
Yeah.
And yeah. The more you can do that for yourself and be open to that experience, the better you can be for the other.
Yeah, very good advice. Let's say, for example, if somebody has lost someone and there's a lot of anger in that grief, a way of trying to kind of work through that can be to see yourselves, you and the person who's died, as two souls. And somehow in approaching the memory of that person soul to soul, it kind of jettisons ego. And it can be a very healing part of the grief process.
From what you just said, when you put the word soul, I think what you're doing is you're getting away from ego and mind.
Mm.
So you don't have to understand what you're doing.
No.
You're just being present. And you're speaking from deep. Sometimes we can use the word heart instead of soul.
Mm.
So you're speaking from deep from within your heart, or you are present from your heart. And you don't know what you're doing all the time.
Mm.
I feel as a therapist, I don't know what I'm doing half the time.
I know that feeling.
I don't have intelligence about it. It's just that it's a different kind of thing. It's more about taking chances and being there as a person and letting my soul feel and speak rather than everything having to be processed through my mind.
Mm, that's a really lovely thing to say. And I think that people will get a lot from that. Caring for for people at the end of life can be really profound, beautiful, inspiring. And it can also be very, very hard. So in your book, you talk about self-care for people. Can you talk about that, please?
Yes, I mentioned just a little bit before about nature, that you can go into nature. But self-care is essential. I if you're going to be useful to another person, you have to pay attention to yourself and feel comfortable and at ease. You can't be full of anxieties. It's a good idea to work out some of the things that make you feel anxious around other people.
Mm.
We all have those kinds of things, but they're all workable. I mean, you can always get somewhere with them. Maybe not resolve them completely, but get somewhere. So the things that are good for the soul are good for someone who helps the self-care. So that would be things like not food for the health of your body, although that's important, but dining is so important.
Mm.
Being able to eat with friends, eat food that has memory for you, that comforts you and gives you some satisfaction. I mean, like I know for me, if I can cook a meal that my mother used to make for me, there's the mother coming in.
Yeah.
I find that very comforting at certain moments. Very yeah. important for me to do that regularly. Or to eat together with certain friends where I know I will feel relaxed and full of pleasure and not want the evening to end.
Yeah.
That is very good for the soul.
Yes.
And many, many things, especially memory. We got to keep that in mind. Anything that allows our memory to be present. So I remember my father playing baseball when I was a child. So if I can go and just throw baseball with somebody, my father's present.
Mm.
And that memory is really helpful to me because yeah. he was such a good guide for me. And if I can return to him in some way, then that through that activity, it's just a slight memory and it's not terribly, you don't have to talk too much about it, but it's enough to comfort me.
Mm.
Music, I studied music all my life.
Yeah.
So for me to go to the piano, when most that's the main thing for me if I'm in real distress or I'm talking to someone who is very distressed. If I go to the piano, that's going to prepare me for another day of work because it gives so much back to me.
Can you, on that note, can you say a little bit about Marsilio Ficino's approach to music and care for the soul and his way of caring for someone's soul?
Well, I have to talk to you for several hours about that. Marsilio Ficino was a remarkable person who lived in the 15th century in Florence, Italy. And he developed a way of living, and as he would put it, making soul part of your entire existence.
Mm-hmm.
Very concretely. And part of that was music. So he played a string instrument. He called it his Orphic lyre.
Yeah.
Orpheus was this god of the Greeks who played a string instrument and then all of nature was charmed by it.
Yes.
He could bring the natural world to life through his music. So he called himself an Orphic musician. And if people were, we have records of this, if people were depressed, for example, he would tell them, come to my house and I'll play you some Saturnine music. That means some sad music. He liked to go with your feeling rather than against it. So he would play some happy music at times, but he said, that's not really the thing that's going to help. Mm-hmm. What you need is to let your emotion be supported by this music and take you somewhere and expand it through music.
Yeah. I find when I look back at Ficino, it's interesting, when you look at the end of the 15th century, in a strange way, he's in a very similar time to the one that we're in now. There was a profusion of art and ideas and things, and the printing press had been invented, which was their kind of internet for the dissemination of so many new ideas. But along with that was their pandemic plague was still sweeping Europe. There was increasing poverty and gaps between rich and poor. rising fundamentalism and sort of riots in the street. And yet here he was offering this wonderful soul medicine. So, and in his approach, he looked, as you say, at music, the art that we look at, the colors we have around us, the nature we spend time in. To me, he feels incredibly current for today. Do you see a sort of, a revival of Ficinian physicians or something? Would you like to see something like that happen?
I would love to see it. But do I see it? Not too much. Maybe little elements here and there. But I don't see it happening in a way that it really is on the horizon. There are slight movements in that direction, maybe, but one thing Ficino did with music I could mention is that, and I do see elements here today. He suggested that you don't just listen to any music, you know, that's around. He suggested that you pay attention to what you're feeling at the moment, or what you're experiencing, what your life experience is right now. Mm. And choose music that will support that, and that will give it resonance, give it more depth. And so if you're like I said before, if you're depressed, get some sad music, kind of sad music that will just take you further into that emotion that is appropriate for you right now. Mm. And I think for the, speaking of the dying person, choosing music is and having the right music, having the right colors, mm-hmm. having even the right aromas. You know, Ficino was big on aroma.
Yeah.
And even smoke, different kinds of smoke, like incense or things like that, were very important to him.
Yes.
So if you put the music and the aromas and the colors, and maybe touch, things you could touch, the things that you feel, all around you, that would be, I think, a wonderful way to move toward this special time of dying.
Wonderful. Thank you so much. I really hope, I'm sure, that your book is going to do incredibly well. I think that there is such a need for a conversation with soul in the health professions, and particularly in our day with our pandemic and the way that that is creating disconnect and things for people. Thomas, look, thank you so much. I have thoroughly enjoyed having you here with me in the Soul Garden today. And I wish you every success for this book. Dare I ask you if you've got any more up your sleeve?
I do. I have several. I have a few already written, just waiting to put out there. Some, I don't know if they'll be published, but I have a book called Tales of Emptiness. So maybe, I'm sure you know the idea of emptiness in the East. Mm-hmm. It's such an important concept for me to be. Not to be full of agendas, and not to take things literally too much. Mm. Yeah, that's all emptiness as far as I'm concerned. It's so important. And there have been stories in all the cultures, simple stories about empty things, like an empty pot or an empty carriage. There's a Jewish story about an empty carriage that is beautiful. There are lots of stories about emptiness. So what I've done is collected them, and I write a commentary on each story, trying to bring out a different aspect of emptiness through the story. So that's one thing. And another, I've written a novel. I write fiction that I don't publish usually.
Right.
So I have a novel, a detective story, but the underlying story is the possibility that Jesus was studied Buddhism in Egypt. So I enjoy that very much, but that I doubt there'll be a publisher interested in it.
Could you also actually say a little bit about your soul psychology course? that you're teaching
on? I love this course. I have to say, it just was a thought to me. I thought I'd take a chance and see if anyone would be interested. So what it is a year-long course, a series of courses. And each course is 6 weeks long. Mm-hmm. And each lesson in the course has a different theme of things that I thought were important in my own studies over the years. It's not school at all. I don't like this idea of school.
No.
It's not that at all. It's very simple, but I offer some very short readings, very, very short. And then people read them and they talk about them with each other online. And I give a talk once a week and on the theme. That's all it is. But I really think these things are very strong. And I think these themes are very, very deep and strong. I think that if someone were to take this whole year-long course, I think their lives might be transformed, not by me, but by the material.
Thomas, look, thank you so much, and good luck with everything. And I look forward to seeing you again, hopefully soon in your next.
Very nice. I'd love that. Thank you. And thank you for having me and talking to me and for the work you're doing, which is precious.
Oh, thank you so much. Thomas More's new book, Soul Therapy, is published by Harper One and available in all good bookshops, online, and as an audio CD version. You can find his soul psychology course at thomasmoresoul.com. And you can find me, Georgina Langdale, at centernatureconnection.org. Until next time, farewell from the Soul Garden.